Okay, so thanks a lot. So I'm going to try to explain a little bit the history of Hilbert 17 problem, why there are some issues in getting effective bounds on the degrees. And I'll tell you what are the recent results we obtained. So it's a very simple problem to start with. The question is, if you have a non-negative polynomial, by this I mean a polynomial which takes only non-negative values, is it a sum of squares of polynomials? And of course, if in the case of number of variables equals to 1, the answer is yes. And that's because you can decompose a real polynomial into parts of say complex roots, which are obviously sums of squares. And then if the polynomial is non-negative, it means that all the real roots appear also with an even power. So it is very simple in this case to see that. But and also if the degree is 2, because if you have a quadratic polynomial, which is everywhere non-negative, then you can decompose it as a sum of squares of linear functions. But in general, it is not. And the first explicit example is due to Motzkin. So you are comparing, in fact, the arithmetic and geometric mean of three numbers. And this is always non-negative. But it's not very complicated to see that it cannot be a sum of squares of polynomials. You just try to write it as a sum of squares of polynomials, and you find immediately some impossibilities. So, in fact, Hilbert 17 problem was in fact the problem which was asked by Hilbert in his famous series of problems conference in Paris. And it was reformulated apparently by Minkowski. So Minkowski suggested to prove that a non-negative polynomial is in fact a sum of squares of rational functions. So that is, if you allow denominators, then you will be able to express any positive polynomial as a sum of squares. And in fact, what's very interesting in the history of this topic, that it was proved by Artin. So Artin gave an affirmative answer. A non-negative polynomial is always a sum of squares of rational functions, but we don't have any construction, so we would like to know how it could be possible to construct it, to know something on the degree, and so on. Yes? Yes, yes, but they didn't have, exactly. So in fact, Hilbert approved, I gave you the two easy cases. There are a few more extra cases, but basically that's more or less it. I mean, one polynomial in one variable, any degree in one variable, or degree 2 in two variables, in any number of variables, sorry. And then a very few other cases that Hilbert already knew about. And he suspected that these are the only cases. And I think he had a kind of very indirect construction of a polynomial which was not a sum of squares. But finally, there was this very simple example of Motzkin, but that appeared really much, much later, in fact. And now that there is a whole collection of counterexamples, so we have a specialist, Bruce Resnick, and who has many papers on that. It's a very interesting topic. Okay, so I'm going to tell you about the proof of Artin, and you'll see why it is non-constructive, and then I'll tell you what has been the approaches to some constructive proofs. Okay, so here is an outline of Artin's proof. So you start by supposing that the polynomial is not a sum of squares of rational functions. So it will be a proof by contraposition. Okay? You are not going to start from the fact that the polynomial takes only non-negative values and construct the sum of squares. You start from the fact that the polynomial is not a sum of squares. So if it's not a sum of squares, it means that the sum of squares of this field form a proper cone which doesn't contain p. A proper cone is what? It's something which contains the square and is closed under addition and multiplication. Proper cone doesn't contain minus 1. So if P is not a sum of squares, it means that there are proper cones inside this field, and P is a number of these. Okay, now using Zorn's lemma, we can get a maximal proper cone which doesn't contain P. And in fact, such a maximal proper cone defines the total order on the field of rational functions. So from the fact that P is not a sum of squares, you find that P does not belong to a given, well, not given, constructed, or not really constructed, because you need to use Zanzema to get it. There is a total order on the field of rational function which doesn't contain P. And then, from this total order, you can construct what is called the real closure of the field of rational functions. So what is the real closure? The real closure, so maybe I should write the axioms for real closed field. So what is a real closed field? A real closed field is going to be an ordered field. With two extra properties, any non-negative element is a square, and any odd degree polynomial has a root. So it is some algebraic approach to real numbers, if you like. That's what is replacing the axioms of algebraically closed field in the context of real numbers. Okay, so whenever you have a total order, you can construct what is called the real closure of the field, which is the smallest real closed field with this definition, which is containing the order with the induced, the field with this induced order. And since P was negative for the total order we were considering, it means that P is taking, in fact, negative values inside this real closed field, simply by evaluating it at the variables, which are now elements of the real closed field. And then you have a transfer principle in real algebraic geometry that was in fact established by Artin at that time, that if you have a polynomial P with real coefficients that take negative values in some real closed extension of the reals, then, by transfer principle, you will find a point where it is indeed negative. And this was based, he was using Strom theorem, or if you prefer, quadratic form, which was constructed by Hermite. And that's the outline of Artin's proof. So it's, of course, extremely beautiful and very spectacular also, because you are at the end proving something very concrete about a polynomial with real coefficients, except that you have to go through this very complicated construction, Zanzema, and then the real closure, and then coming back, you find a negative value.
Why does P take negative values over the real closure?
Hmm?
Is it easy to say? Is it easy to state?
What? So P is not in the positive cone.
Oh, that's...
Okay, so it means that when you evaluate it at the variables...
Right, okay, thank you.
Okay. So at the generic point, in a way, it is strictly negative. It isn't.
Thanks.
Okay. So yes. So it's really very spectacular, and it was very striking at that time, and it's still, I think. And of course, it's a very indirect proof because it's by contraposition. It's using Zorn. It's also using the construction of the real closure. And at the end, you didn't construct at all the sum of squares. Okay. And it's interesting that in his paper, Artin is saying that my proof is very indirect, and it would be very interesting to give some construction, but in fact, he never did it. And so his proof is giving absolutely no hint on the denominators. We don't know even if there are some degree bounds on the denominator that would be independent on the specific coefficients of the polynomial, for example. So there are two kinds of problems. There are some effectivity problems. First, is there an algorithm which is checking if a given polynomial takes only non-negative values? If so, is there an algorithm which is producing the sum of squares? And the complexity problem, what are the best possible bounds? Are there bounds, or what can we say about the best possible bounds on the degree of the polynomials in this representation? Okay, so it seems that Artin discussed with Kreisel, so because that was the beginning of modern proof theory. So Artin thought that maybe these logicians could do something to his favorite problem. And in fact, indeed, Kreisel and his student Deakin, and then later on, other people, Henri Lombardi and the student of Eberhard Becker, Schmidt, gave some constructive proofs with primitive recursive degree bounds. So what does it mean? It means, in fact, that you have something like, so you have two parameters, the degree and the number of variables, and you construct, so basically they construct the tower of exponentials, and the 8 is more or less k, or 4k, I don't remember, and the degree will be somewhere like that. So 2 to the 2 to the 2 to the 2 with the degree upstairs, and this thing here is depending on the number of variables. That's a primitive recursive function of d and k.
So here the coefficients, what do we, the coefficients of the polynomials, they're in the same...
Yes, well, we are going to see, yes. Yes, well, for the moment I'm not mentioning that. It's not so clear that it was, I don't know, I mean, I would have to rethink a little more of Artin proof, but we are going to prove that they belong, in fact, in the same way. And what we are doing now, that our recent work, is another constructive proof with an elementary recursive degree bound. It means that now the 8 of the tower of exponentials is no more depending on the number of variables, but it is only 5. So 2 to the 2 to the 2 to the d to the 4 to the k, where d is the degree and k is the number of variables. Okay, so I'll tell you a little bit how this 5 is coming from. So in order to prove this Hilbert 17 problem, it is kind of more pleasant to work in a slightly more general framework, which is positive Chalanzas. And in general, it will be the following problem. Find algebraic identities which certify that a system of same conditions is empty. And as a particular case, we'll see that it will imply Hilbert 17 problem. So if you want, it's in the spirit of classical Hilbert Michelansatz, which is the following. If you have a system of algebraic equations with coefficients in an algebraically closed field, so here you see I'm insisting on the coefficients, it's the question of Pablo. So we have a field K, then an algebraically closed extension, and we want to characterize the fact that there are no solutions inside CK, so in the big field. And in fact, you get an identity which is in the little field. You are saying that one is in the ideal generated by the polynomials. Okay, so let's think a little bit why this is a proof of the fact that there are no solutions. Because if I write A1 P1 plus ASPS equal 1, and I evaluate at any point, I'm going to have A1 of x, P1 of x plus CS of x, PS of x equals 1, which means that it's absolutely impossible that there is a simultaneous solution for P1 and PS, because that would give 0 equals 1 for a specific value, which is not possible. Okay, so this is a certificate, an algebraic certificate, of the fact that there are no solutions over the complexes. And this has been very well studied, and I'll tell you something about the degree bounds in this case. It is very well known. Okay, so now, well, there are other cases, like Farkas-Lemma. So now we look at an ordered field and its real closed extension. And we have a system now of linear inequalities. We are saying that a given system of linear inequalities and equalities has no solution in RK. And by Farkas-Lemma, it means that there is some combination of with non-negative coefficients lambda i. Okay, that's 1 plus a non-negative combination of things which are supposed to be non-negative, plus a linear combination of things which are supposed to be equal 0, and this is again a certificate of impossibility. Why? Because if you plug in any value, you will find here, if this value is satisfying this inequality and this equality, then this 1 plus something non-negative plus something equals 0 will be strictly positive. And something strictly positive cannot be equal to something which is zero. Okay, so the positive Chalanzatz is a generalization for arbitrary degrees over the real numbers, and the statement is slightly more complicated. So it is as follows. So in the spirit of this SOS proof that have been discussed here, so you take a set of hypotheses, H, which are a collection of non-zero polynomials, non-negative polynomials, and zero polynomials, and you look for the condition for them to have no solutions in Rk.
Well,
there will have no solutions in Rk if and only if there exists some S, N, and Z. So I'm saying deduce from H of X using SOS proof, so we'll see a little more precisely what it means. But very simple proofs that prove from this hypothesis that S is strictly positive, N is non-negative, Z equals zero, and S plus N plus Z equals zero. Again, this is a certificate of impossibility, because if you plug in any value in S, it will be any value in S, which is a solution, which is verifying the hypothesis H, it will take a strictly positive value, N will take a non-negative value, Z will take a zero value, and the addition of the three will cannot be equal to zero. And of course, what is difficult in this case, every time I told you, if this is true, then there are no solutions. What's complicated? If I know that there are no solutions, how do I find the identity in question?
So,
for example, if I go back to the two other examples I gave you, for example, for Farkas-Lemma, well, this is just, linear programming, which is giving you these solutions. And in the case of Hilbert Muchelenzas, it's just the theory of the ideals. You just look in the ideal generator. You can say something on the bound on the degrees, and it's not too complicated. But for the positive Muchelenzas, in general, it is quite complicated. Okay, so what do we mean by a short proof of the fact that S is strictly positive? It means, in fact, that we can write S as a product of the square of the elements which are supposed to be non-zero.
Okay,
so if I take something which is not zero, I square it, and then I take the product. If I suppose that I have an X which is satisfying the hypothesis, then this S of X is going to be strictly positive. N will be in the cone associated to this hypothesis. So what is it? It will be some sum of products. So there are some non-negative coefficients here multiplied by squares. And then I multiply them by the polynomials which are given as non-negative. And in the ideal, it's just the ideal generated to the same equation. Okay. So again, if I suppose that these hypotheses are true, then any x which is satisfying the hypothesis will satisfy S of x strictly positive, N of x non-negative, Z of x equals zero. It means I'm going to have something impossible since all this sum is equal to zero. And now, well, what do we define as the degree of this incompatibility? So that's a little tricky, and it was mentioned also that in these sums of squares proofs, you have to be careful with the not mixing up the algebraic, what's called syntactical degree and the real degree, because of course S plus N plus Z is equal to zero, so it means it has no degree at all, it's just zero. Okay, so you have to keep track of the degree of the various pieces, okay? Like you are going to say that the degree of H is going to be the maximum degree of each of the syntactic pieces that you see when you write a formula. Okay, so for example, I think it's clear to you that this has no solution in R2, right? So, let's get from a very simple picture, because what are we doing? Well, we are taking a parabola like this. Then we are intersecting it with x times y equals zero, but we are saying that x is not zero. Okay? So, we would have an intersection if we were taking xy equals zero, but if we say that x is not zero, then of course we have no intersection. So this is empty, and you see it from this picture. Okay, now I want to produce a certificate which is going to prove that it is empty. So it means I have three hypotheses: x is not zero, y minus x squared minus 1 is non-negative, xy equals 0, and I should find something which is strictly positive plus something which is non-negative plus something which is equal to 0 according to the hypothesis, and find that it is equal to 0. So here it is. Okay. If you write this, and you see that there are some cancellation in this, this is cancelling with this and so on. This is an incompatibility of degree 4. You see that this belongs to the cone because this is a square, and this is a square multiplied by something which was non-negative. This is the square of something which was non-zero, and this is in the ideal. Okay? And for us, in this case, we say that the degree is equal to 4. Okay? Because we look at the degree of each of the pieces, and this is 4. Okay, so if you want, you can see this identity. I mean, that was a proof by the picture, and this is another proof of the fact that the set is empty.
Okay,
by some algebraic identity. Some SOS proof that it is empty.
Okay,
so now what can we say about the classical, the proofs of the positive Stellensatz? So the positive Stellensatz is the fact that for any system of incompatible, of inequalities which is impossible over the reals, there exists such S, N, and Z. So the classical proofs are based on Zahn's lemma and the transfer principle, or transfer principle.
S missing here.
And it, in fact, it's very similar to Artin's proof for Hilbert 17 problems. So it's not much more complicated to prove the general positive Stellensatz. And then, constructive proofs are using always as an intermediate step the quantifier elimination over the reals. So, of course, I mean, I think I'm pretty sure that many of you know quantifier elimination, even though we think they don't know, they do know, in fact, because that's a typical example, I mean, with polynomial of degree 2. The conditions for the existence of the real roots is something you can express directly with sign conditions on some expression of the coefficients. And what, why is it called? Oh, sorry. Why is it called quantifier elimination?
Because
here you had the quantifier, which was there exists x, and here you don't have any, so it has been eliminated. And in fact, it's something very general, which is true for any formula. So it's all due to Tarski, and it's using generalization of Strom theorem of Hermite quadratic form, and it's not very very complicated. In fact. And so finally, if we have a system of sign condition which is empty, we are going to give a constructive proof using quantifier elimination over the reals. And then we are going to transform such a proof that it is empty, step by step, into algebraic incompatibility, which is really expressing that it is empty. So you use quantifier elimination to have a proof that the corresponding system of sign conditions is empty. And from this proof, you have now to create a whole bunch of techniques for constructing this satellite.
Okay, so what can we say about the various approaches?
So there was first a result by Henri Lombardi 24 years ago. And he was using Cohen-Ormander algorithm for quantifier elimination, which is one of the most basic algorithms for quantifier elimination. And he was getting an exponential tower of 8 k plus 4 with d log d log log s plus c on the top.
Okay.
And now our work, which is based on a variant of cylindrical decomposition, we're going to get result of this kind. So again, you see the 5, 2 to the 2 to the... Okay, and when d,
so
more or less from this bound, you will see that we can recover the bound I gave before on Hilbert 17 problem. So the difference between these two things is which quantifier elimination method we are using. This is using a kind of old-fashioned quantifier elimination method. This is using something a little more modern quantifier elimination. If we were able to use even better quantifier eliminations, we could even improve this result. But that's what we are able to. Okay. Now I want to tell you why, if I have the positive Stellensatz, I'm going to prove easily Hilbert 17 problem. So in fact, if P is non-negative everywhere in RK, it means that P of X strictly negative has no solution.
Okay?
P of X strictly negative has no solution. As a system of same conditions, it is P of X different from zero, and P of X non-negative has no solution.
Okay,
so it means that there is something strictly positive. Strictly positive means some even power of P, plus something which is in the cone generated by minus P, which is a sum of square, minus P times the sum of square, which is equal to zero.
Okay?
And I have nothing in the ideal because I have no conditions equal to zero in this hypothesis.
Okay?
The fact that this has no solution means that there is an element in the monoin, which is some even power of P, plus an element in the cone, which is the sum of square minus P times the sum of square,
which is equal to zero.
And of course, I can rewrite this, and you see the denominators now. The denominators are coming from this sum of square here, and I can write it as a sum of square divided by as a sum of square rational functions.
Okay.
So if I can solve the positive shell and that, then I can also find the construction. If I have a general construction for systems of same conditions, I can apply it to this very special case and get this expression.
Okay.
So what is the strategy of the proof? That for every system of same conditions which has no solution, we want to construct an algebraic incompatibility and we want to control the degree for the positive shell ansatz. And in order to do that, we use the proof that the set is empty. And we transform this proof that the set is empty step by step by some algebraic identities. And in fact, we use exactly the notion that were already introduced in Lombardi's paper 25 years ago. And the key notion is this of weak inference.
So something rather strange.
So we want to understand what will mean in our strange way of working today. What does it mean that A strictly positive and B non-negative implies A plus B strictly positive? So for us, it will mean the following thing. It means every time that we add a context, and in these two arrows here mean that we have some algebraic incompatibility of the form I gave you before, which means that this has no solution. Of course, I can deduce that this has no solution, because if A of X plus B of X strictly positive together with H has no solution, it means certainly there are no possible values of X which for which that would be true. And this means exactly that H, A strictly positive, B non-negative, is impossible. So it means in order to prove that something implies something, I take any system of hypothesis which is incompatible with the conclusion, and I try to prove that it is also incompatible with the hypothesis. So, in fact, it means that these weak inferences go from right to left. You prove, if you have a contradiction of something that you want to prove, it means that something, that the hypothesis were already impossible.
Okay.
So we are going to do that in that case. So what does it mean that I have an incompatibility between H and A plus B strictly positive?
Okay.
So what does it mean? To have this incompatibility here means what? It means that we are going to have this is simultaneously in the non-zero part and the non-negative part. So it means some even power of A plus B times something which is strictly positive using the hypothesis coming from H, plus something which is non-negative using the hypothesis coming from H, plus something, plus this hypothesis A plus B, plus something which is in the hypothesis 0 from H is equal to 0. So that's expressing the fact that this is incompatible.
Okay?
And I want to rewrite this identity so that you will see that at the end it also means this.
Okay.
So how do I do it? I just develop. So I add a plus b to the 2e times s.
Okay.
So this is a to the 2e times s, which will play the role of this. Which will be. So you see now that this corresponds to this.
Okay.
B non-negative. You see that now b is entered in the sum of squares by developing all this.
Okay.
So if you develop this, you get n prime times a, n prime times b.
Okay.
And then all the parts that were here, once they are developed, they appear now as something which is a consequence of the fact that b is non-negative.
This one should be I, right? This one should be I in the exponent of b.
This one should be I. Which one?
In the exponent of b.
Ah, here, okay, right. Right, exactly. Yes, thank
so
you.
In the n plus n prime times a plus b, don't you need, might be another sum of squares that come?
The n and n prime are elements which are, because here, okay, you could have bigger product, bigger powers of a plus b.
Okay.
But then they enter in the square. So the cone generated by a plus b together with h is just the cone generated by h plus this non-negative element multiplied by an element of the cone generated by h.
Okay.
So in fact, it means in this case, it's just a rewriting of this expression. We develop it, and from what we had here, we just get exactly what we want. Because this is now something which is strictly positive given this hypothesis. This is now something which is non-negative given this hypothesis. And this implies that H together with A is strictly positive and B non-negative is impossible.
Okay?
So you see why the paper is long, like 85 pages, because even explaining what this means is already 3 pages, right? Okay. And so on. And then we have to take care of the degree also. Because of course, I mean, maybe A plus B is of small degree, but maybe A is of big degree and B is of big degree. And then what can we say? It was the same expression. I mean, I told you I've not introduced anything. I'm just developing this. But in terms of the degree, it's not at all the same. In terms of the degree, it's not at all the same, because if we had an initial incompatibility of degree delta, here we have to take into account the difference that the maximum of the degree of A and the degree of B and the degree of A plus B is really not the same. Because maybe here the degree was small because A plus B was of small degree, but if A is of big degree and B of big degree, you have to take it into account. And this is, of course, also putting a lot of technicalities in keeping track of the degree. And that's, of course, absolutely essential, because at the end, we prove that 0 equals 0, so we need to do something about the degree. Okay, so maybe we do another case. For example, it's very useful when you are doing some reasoning to say if A is not 0, then either A is negative or A is positive, right? And again, it's going to be some kind of strange construction. What does it mean? It means that if we have a system of sign condition which is incompatible with the fact that A is negative, it means that this has no solution, plus another system of another algebraic identity which is expressing the fact that A is strictly positive and this hypothesis has no solution, then from these two things, I'm going to deduce that A not zero also has no solution. And this should be, again, an algebraic identity of the same kind.
Okay?
So again, it goes from right to left. I have to suppose that something is impossible with the two conclusions and to construct something that will be impossible with the hypothesis.
Okay, so we do that.
So what does it mean that we have something which is impossible with A negative? This A negative will appear first as A not zero, in the monoid, and then as minus a in the cone. Okay? And same thing for a positive. It will have some even power in the monoid, and then a plus in the cone. Okay, so what do we do? We put this part here, we put it to the right. Okay, so now we get this equals the part which was negative here. Same thing here. The part which is involving minus, which was involving A, we put to the right. We multiply them. Okay. So if we multiply them, what will happen? Well, this, of course, will remain in the monoid. I multiply two elements of the monoid, multiply them. Then when I make all this developing part, I mean, something which was non-negative multiplied by something which is strictly positive will remain non-negative and so on. Finally, I get here, I add this and that multiplied minus. I can put it back on the other part, and now I have a square, so it means the only hypothesis I have about A is that it is not zero. And this is now entered in the square. Okay? And here the degree is simple. It's just the degree of the two hypotheses. Okay? So I mean, producing, starting from something which say that A strictly positive is impossible and that A strictly negative is impossible, I prove that A not zero is also impossible. Okay, so I think it gives you a little flavor of all the things we have to do. So there are many simple weak inferences which are true in ordinary mathematical life that we have to combine in order to obtain more interesting weak inferences in this context. And in fact, we are going to use several tools, some from classical algebra and some from more modern computer algebra. So, for example, the kind of tool we are using, the axiom, a real polynomial of odd degree has a real root. So that was an axiom, but this has now to be transformed into a construction of algebraic identities. A real polynomial has a complex root, and for this we need algebraic proof. So there is an algebraic proof due to Laplace, which is involving a polynomial of very high degree. So that's the two basic things classical algebra. Then we are going to use the fact that the Hermite signature of Hermite quadratic form in fact determines the number of real roots and is also determined by some conditions on principal minors. We are going to use the fact that Sylvester in Herschelot, which is saying that if we have two different ways of dealing with the signature of quadratic form, they have to be the same. And finally, we are going to deal with the realizable sign conditions for a family of univariate polynomials. At the end, we are going to look at sign of minors of several Hermite quadratic forms and things like that, which are also some tools we know from real algebraic geometry. And finally, we come to cylindrical decomposition. So cylindrical decomposition means that, so just as I had initially, I mean, I gave you the example of this degree 2 polynomial depending on x, a, b, c, and I gave you the condition a square minus, b square minus 4ac non-negative. So you generalize this kind of thing. If you have a family of polynomials depending on k variables, you can project them to get a family of polynomials depending now on k minus 1 variables. This is called cylindrical decomposition. And you obtain all the list of realizable sign conditions on the family in k polynomials by looking at all the list of realizable sign conditions on the projection. Okay. So, why do we get a tower of 5 exponentials? So first, the only reason is that it's because that's what our method is giving, because there is no reason for really being convinced that we cannot get better, but okay.
Still like some kind of lower bound. Like I'm sure, like one exponential is probably.
Okay, well I'll tell you about lower bounds later. Okay, so first the construction of cylindrical decomposition, which is eliminating one variable after the other, is giving us doubly exponential degrees. So at the end, we get a family of univariate polynomials of double exponential degree. And for this family of univariate polynomials, we have to deal with finding the complex roots and finding the real root of a polynomial of much bigger degree that appears in the proof of Laplace. So finally, when we deal with this univariate polynomial of degree d, and when we look at its complex root by Laplace, we already get three levels of exponentials, only to express the fact that the polynomial, the univariate polynomial of degree d, has a complex root in this very strange way of working. And in fact, we are kind of lucky. So why is it five? Five, it is because of 3 + 2, because we have double exponential degrees for univariate polynomials, and these univariate polynomials, they have to enter in something which is with 3 levels of exponentials. And of course, then we have to check that we don't get worse than that. But 5 levels of exponentials is pretty stable. So as soon as you get 5 levels of exponentials, you can be a little quiet that it will remain so, but we have to check. And this is, of course, a long paper, so it's
about 85 pages with all the details.
Okay, so as I said, we get these 5 levels of exponentials because our method is giving that for us. We would like to be able to use more advanced, for example, quantifier elimination, like the one that Jim was getting in his paper, that we have been improving also, but this we don't know how to do. So what's the situation? So for the Neustrelensatz, classical Hilbert Neustrelensatz, we know that the truth is single exponential, because there are single exponential degree bounds, and there are also single exponential counterexample. I mean, that examples where you cannot get better than a single exponential degree. Again, in the case of positive Neustrelensatz, again, there is a paper by Grigoriev and Vorobyov, which is also giving single exponential lower bounds. But this does not apply to the case of Hilbert 17 problem, because Hilbert 17 problem is very specific. It's only one polynomial, which is non-negative. So for Hilbert 17 problem, the best degree we know, and that's very recent, it's degree of the denominator in the expression of the sum of squares, which is linear in K.
So maybe Madhu will know, I don't know, Grigoriev, etc.
No, Grigoriev, that's what I was quoting. That's for the positive Neustrelensatz, not for the... for the real Neustrelensatz, not for Hilbert 17 problem.
No, so can't you make it into a single polynomial, like if you have
No.
Not the Grigoriev-Volobjov result, but for the polynomial coming from a three-set formula is a degree 3 polynomial, which requires linear degree.
Yes. I'm saying and that there are some...
Remove this constraint that you're on the Boolean
cube. I'm saying that there are single exponential lower bounds when we have many polynomials, and we have one single polynomial. I mean, the case of Hilbert 17 problem, we know that we only know by a recent result of Bleckermann and company that it can be linear, even if it was not known before. So he constructed a family of degree 4 polynomial, which requires denominators of linear degree to express it as a sum of squares. So the truth is between this level of 5 exponentials and linear. That's what we know today. Okay? And of course, we could hope, because there are also other things which are single exponential for the real numbers, like deciding the emptiness for the reals. And that's, I was putting the work of Jim and also of what we are doing. But this, we are not able to translate into algebraic identities for the moment, because it's a little too more geometric, and we don't know how to do it.
Okay.
And
these are the references.
So that's the result I was quoting of by Bleckermann. That's the Grigoriev-Vorobyov. So that's our paper, and then this two notes.